In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth.
A spirit hovered above the waters, and a new creation appeared.
This spirit shaped and formed the world, entering the dust of the earth and bringing forth humanity.
In the beginning of Jesus' ministry, God prepared to bring forth a new creation.
And a spirit entered into Jesus.
It was his baptism.
The beginning of a new life for all creation.
Let us worship.
I can still see the steeple, a little church on the hill. There was a line at the altar, and every pew had been filled.
Let us pray. Magnificent God, we gather in the name of the one who was baptized in the Jordan, Jesus Christ. Let us hear again your words of grace and be immersed in your Spirit. Pour out your love through the music and the message of this service, allowing for us to be more fully possessed with the vision that you have for our lives. It is in the name of Christ Jesus that we pray. Amen.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the
today I am coming to you from the Centrum, and I'm preaching from the specific place where the new baptistry will be installed. I hope it's not too long before it actually arrives and they're able to put it in. But today it just made sense to be here because it is Baptism of the Lord Sunday. And I want us to look at Mark's gospel and Mark's telling of the baptism of Jesus, his baptism by John. In chapter 1, verses 9 through 12, we read the following. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as Jesus was coming up out of the waters, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven and said, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And then the Spirit immediately drove Jesus out into the wilderness. May such a baptism be our experience today, a baptism of the Spirit, a Spirit of grace and mercy and peace. Holy One, made real in the waters of baptism, provide us a clear vision of your gospel, of your message found in these words from Mark's gospel. It is in the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Well, we've come a long way in a few weeks. I mean, just a little over 2 weeks ago, we were celebrating the birth of Jesus. Last Sunday, we were watching the Magi, the wise men, come alongside and find the Holy Family when Jesus was still but a young child. And today, we're standing alongside the Jordan River with John the Baptist, who is baptizing Jesus, who's probably 30 years old. That's a pretty big leap in a short period of time. It's interesting to me, on many occasions about this time of the year, people have asked me, why is it that I do not preach more of the stories about when Jesus was a boy or a youth? Well, the reason I do not is because there's just not very many stories. In fact, there's really just one such story about the Holy Family taking a trip to Jerusalem, and on their way back, Mary and Joseph realize Jesus isn't with them. And so they go back and they find Jesus in the temple, and he's teaching. It's a great story, but that's about it. Well, unless you look at some of the non-canonical books, that may not be a term you know. It's basically those writings that didn't make the cut. When they were bringing together what we know as the New Testament, there were a lot of writings that simply were not included for one reason or another. But many of those books and writings include stories about when Jesus was a boy or a youth. A few of those stories, I will give you examples of what they're like. There's one such story when the child of another religious leader did something that upset Jesus. And so Jesus, he wanted that boy to wither. And the boy withered and died. In another situation, a boy bumps into Jesus alongside the road and Jesus curses him. And that boy dies. When some of the townspeople get a little upset about what's going on, they approach Joseph, the father of Jesus, and what Jesus does is he blinds some of them. Perhaps, though, my favorite story found in these non-canonical books is the story of Jesus playing with some other boys, and yet the other boys go and hide. And I think Jesus is a little angry because he turns them into goats. I love that story. These are just a few, though, of the examples of stories that you can find outside of Scripture telling, well, some of the experiences or so-called experiences of Jesus when he was a boy. But let me just say, I am rather thankful that such stories are not in the Bible. I mean, I don't know how I would preach on them. I don't know how I would preach on the story of Jesus turning a bunch of boys into goats. Those types of stories, they just don't line up with the Jesus that I meet in the four Gospels that we have in our Bible. They don't line up with the Jesus that I have met in my own spiritual journey. Now, some scholars speculate that such stories begin to emerge in response to the Roman culture and expectations around hero stories. Usually, such hero stories included stories of the hero's childhood, often depicting the child as unusually strong and skilled, while also showing that the child was a bit rambunctious, shall we say. Well, I look at some of those stories of Jesus when he was a young person, and that sounds a little beyond rambunctious to me. And again, I'm thankful that they're not found in our Bibles. Well, why is it that I'm talking about those stories on the day that we're talking about the baptism of Jesus? Well, it's because the church has struggled and debated over what exactly happened at the baptism. Was it simply a confirmation of what Jesus already knew about himself? Or was it Jesus' awakening, his, shall we call it, his realization and installation as the Christ? Did Jesus know all the way back at age 3 exactly who he was and where his life journey was going to go? Or did Jesus kind of grow into his power with a few bumps along the way? Or was Jesus just like most other kid, well, except that his mother had some pretty high expectations of him based upon a certain angelic visitor? And Jesus did grow into those expectations. Trust me when I say there has been a fair number of discussions and debates over the centuries over what exactly happened at the baptism and what Jesus knew before the baptism versus what he knew after the baptism. And some of those beliefs were declared heretical. For instance, one known as adoptionism that suggested that Jesus, at his baptism, was adopted as the Son of God, but was not the Son of God prior to that. This is all to say that Mark's gospel not only leaves some of those questions unanswered, but I think actually muddies the water just a little bit. And yet as we splash around in some of that muck looking for what might be relevant, I find that there is one idea that is of specific interest to me, one that I want to pull out there and kind of wipe off and discuss today. In Mark's gospel, there's a real interesting discussion about possession. And when I say possession, I'm talking about a possession by a demon or an evil spirit or by a power other than God. Now, clearly we need to acknowledge some stuff that is happening that was a bit difficult for us in our modern thinking to understand. I mean, for instance, one young boy who has epilepsy. Well, they describe him in Mark's gospel as being possessed by a demon. I want to be cautious here and suggest that such illnesses, such diseases are not demonic possessions. Science has showed us otherwise, and that there are in fact good medications that people can take and other things that can help individuals. And we don't want to dismiss that because we believe something else. And yet Mark tells a lot of stories about people being possessed by things that are not of God, that keep them from living the life that God would want them to live. And you put all those stories alongside the baptism of Jesus, and there's an interesting kind of back and forth play that is going on here. Because as Jesus is removing from other people the demonic spirits, What we find at the baptism of Jesus, well, it sure appears as if Jesus becomes possessed in that moment by the Spirit of God. And if you look at the original Greek of Mark's gospel, all the verbs that are associated with Jesus are passive verbs, while all the verbs associated with God are active verbs. It sounds as if whatever it is that is coming upon Jesus is not his choice. It is entering Jesus, but it is coming from an outside source. Now, this could have us chasing our tails in regard to the implications of whether Jesus was the Christ before the baptism or not. It could have us struggling over what Jesus knew and what Jesus didn't know. And I don't want us to get caught up in that game right now. Instead, I want us to focus on another question. I want us to talk about what it is that possesses you. How open are you, really? How open are you to the Spirit of God? How receptive are you? How much room is there within you for God to dwell versus other stuff that is not of God that is dwelling within you? A number of years ago, I taught a class on the fruit of the Spirit. That's the idea of Paul, the fruit of the Spirit being love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And in the class, one of the assignments I gave them was to take home these charts that I had created, and every single day to look at each of the fruit of the Spirit and to rate oneself. How did I do? How did I do in regard to love? I'm going to give myself an 8 today. Joy? I was really feeling joyful today. I'm going to give myself a 9. How about peace? Well, I did get angry today. I'm going to put that as a 6. And patience? I'm going to give myself a 3, and I think that's a gift. And then going through all the fruit of the Spirit. They did it every day, and then they brought their charts to class the following week. And I asked them to look at their 2 lowest scores. And then I posed this question: what inside of you is keeping you from bearing that fruit in a more powerful way? And the answers that people shared were fascinating. As people talked about experiences in their past that seemed to be very influential, things that continue to haunt them. Interesting word choice there. Stuff that they could not quite let go of, and other stuff that seemed to have a tight grip on them. Or maybe past experiences that continue to consume them. A lot of the language that was used in that conversation is language that we find in Scripture when we're talking about someone being possessed by something other than God. And so I ask you today, what possesses you that is not of God? What is it that is taking up space in your life that might be interfering, holding you back from receiving more of God into your life? What is it that is keeping the fruit of the Spirit from more fully dwelling in your life and taking root and nourishing not only you, but those around you? Now, I know that our modern minds scoff at the notion of being possessed by some evil spirit. Well, outside of that, horror movie we watched last Friday, we really did get kind of caught up in. But I do believe, in fact, that there is stuff within us that shapes our decision-making in unhealthy ways, stuff that we did not really choose to come and be a part of us. It just kind of showed up. It maybe has been there even since we were young. And it's almost as if it is determining more of our life than we are, that we are allowing God to determine. My mother She was a snapper. Now, what do I mean by a snapper? If we were doing something wrong or she wanted us to pay attention, she'd go, hey, 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 and snap at us. Fast forward, I'm in college. I'm coaching gymnastics, a girls' gymnastics team. And one day they're not paying attention, they're goofing off, and I said, hey, 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 listen up, listen up. And all of a sudden I'm looking at my hand going, where did that come from? But I knew exactly where it had come from. It was a part of my mom that was a part of me, and yet where had that been stored, and what is it that brought it forward, brought it out of me? Now, let me say something here. You know, there are parts of me that are from my mother that are really quite wonderful and glorious. But there is stuff in all of our lives that has come from outside influences that all of a sudden appears and we go, where did that come from? And yet at the same time, there is really good stuff. Maybe you've said to somebody, you know, there's a lot of your grandmother in you, or I see a lot of your grandfather in you. And we may not be talking about physical features at all. We're talking about something inside of that person, something that lives, exists, resides there. Well, if that kind of good stuff can exist, can be a part of a person, well, then there is other stuff that can also sneak in, stuff that is unhealthy, that in fact can be rather destructive to us and to those around us. What do we allow to dwell? What do we allow to stay? What is it that is snuck in that we need to acknowledge and then we need to exercise and remove so that there is more room for God to dwell, more room for the attributes of God, more room for the fruit of the Spirit to take root and to blossom and bless us and to bless those around us. Sometimes that stuff within us, it requires a counselor for us to sort some of that out. Sometimes it takes an accountability partner who will walk alongside us. Maybe a spiritual director could be of help. Or maybe just the listening ear of a Stephen minister. But sometimes it requires some help, some assistance from someone else. But there are things that we can do individually if we're intentional. Maybe when it comes to the study of Scripture and what we learn about the life of Jesus. Maybe more intentional prayer or more active spiritual practices and disciplines on a daily basis. Those kinds of things can allow where there is space in our lives for God to come in and to more fully dwell. And as God takes up space in our lives, those things that we want out can sometimes be pushed out as God moves more fully in. Dr. Ed Towns was a professor, a theology professor, when I was doing graduate school. And I took a class from him on the Holy Spirit. It was one of my favorite classes. And I still have the notebook from that class. And there were a number of things that I wrote in there that I will return to. But one day, Dr. Towns was talking about things that he had observed about people. And he said, I think that a lot of people have a void in their lives, an emptiness. And they can go on living pretty healthy and happy lives with that void, that emptiness. But if they're not really paying attention, Dr. Towns said, that void, that emptiness will begin pulling in stuff to fill it up. Things like resentment and anger and hostility and discontent and even bitterness. Those things will begin to fill up that void in a person's life. And a once relatively happy individual will find themselves suddenly being driven by something that they didn't realize was there. Asking themselves, where did that come from? And yet this power within them that they allowed to come into that, that emptiness, that void, is now a pretty strong force in their life, in their decision making, and in how they think and act in the world. Those words from Dr. Towns have really kind of haunted me over the years and have pushed me to try to be intentional and to be really thoughtful about the work that I do in regard to my own life, recognizing that it does take work to make space for God to dwell and to push out other stuff, to make space for the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, and gentleness, and self-control, for that to take root in my life. We need to make space. We need to make room. I don't know exactly what Jesus knew before the baptism versus after the baptism. I don't know what exactly happened at that moment of baptism. But today I really want us to focus on what I think Mark was encouraging us to do. To recognize that there's stuff in our lives that needs to be removed. And as it is removed, there is something of God that needs to enter in, that needs to take root, that needs to fill that space, to fill that void. And if God becomes more and more a part of our lives, if the fruit of the Spirit becomes more and more a part of our lives, it will begin to not only bless us and nourish us, it will become a blessing and a source of nourishment to those around us. And sisters and brothers, right now, we need to acknowledge the fact that our world needs people who have the fruit of the Spirit dwelling in their hearts. The love, the peace, the patience, the kindness, the generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. The world needs more people who have those gifts as a part of their own lives and allowing those gifts to blossom and to bless those around them. Allow those gifts to enter into your life. Allow for the things that are not of God, that are unhealthy and destructive. Allow those to be pushed out. It'll take the help of others sometimes. You will have to invite others to come alongside you and assist you in that work. But the more of that stuff that we push out, the more space will be available for God, for God's Spirit, for the fruit of the Spirit to dwell within us. Would you join me in prayer? Come anew this day, gracious God, as we pause in this space where a baptistry will soon exist, where individuals will follow the example of Jesus and enter the waters, allowing themselves to be immersed, enveloped by the waters. We pray, O God, for the ongoing work of this space, for the restoration of this centrum. And we pray, O God, that this sacred gathering center will truly be a blessing not only to the Cypress Creek Christian Church community, but to groups and organizations throughout our community that will use it. We pray, O God, that this space will be a tool by which you and the attributes of your Spirit might come and dwell within the lives of more and more people. We know, O God, that our community, our nation, and our world need those gifts. And so we ask, in the name of Christ Jesus, that they dwell within us, that they dwell within our church, and that they are able to spill out on the lives of others. We ask this in your most holy name. Amen.
Spirit of God, descend upon my heart. Wean it from earth, through all its pulses move. Stoop to my weakness, mighty as thou art, and make me love thee. as I ought to love. Teach me to feel that thou art always nigh. Teach me the struggles of the soul to bear, to check the rising doubt, the rebel sigh. Teach me the patience of unanswered prayer.
As we move a little further into Mark's Gospel, the third chapter, we come upon a story where the family of Jesus is looking for him because, well, they're concerned about him. They've heard word that he has been taken over by a demon, by an evil spirit. Well, Jesus then explains to them, based upon what he's been doing, that Satan can't cast out Satan. He's basically saying that evil can't push out evil, that darkness can't push out darkness, that in fact it requires goodness. It requires grace. It requires light. It requires the attributes of God if we want to see those things pushed out. Jesus does a wonderful job of talking about what is required to push out what is not of God so that there is room for God to more fully dwell. It's one of the things that I like about the ritual of communion. We don't just talk about it. We take something tangible and we allow it to enter into our bodies. In the same way that I think we need to allow for the Spirit of God to enter into our lives, the attributes of God to more fully dwell, where the fruit of the Spirit can really take root and blossom and nourish not only us, but those around us. Allow for communion to be a reminder of what you need to do on a regular basis to make room for God to enter in, to make space so that God can more fully dwell in your life. Because the more God dwells within you, the more your life, the decisions you make, the way you act and interact with others will be a reflection of who God is. And clearly, that is what our world needs today. Let us prepare now for a time at the table.
Creative through the years. called indeed to share the cup of water and bread with all in need, to work till God's compassion and righteousness prevail, will all this planet's people know justice without fail.
At this time, let us look back to the night of the Last Supper and the words of Christ detailed in 1 Corinthians. For I received of the Lord what I've also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, also after supper, stating, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." The table is set. All is prepared. All are welcome.
Let us pray. Holy Spirit, we come together this morning filled with your presence. Help us to continue to practice this positive mindset and stay focused on your goodness. Thank you for continuing to speak to our hearts. As we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we remember the words your Son taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Thank you.
Thanks so much for joining me today here in the Centrum at the place where the baptistry will soon exist. I know looking around, you kind of wonder what's been happening. Well, I tell you, I'm learning so much about construction and what has to happen behind the scenes, or in this case, behind the walls. So much cabling, so much wiring that needs to be run if we're going to be able to do what we want to do in this space in regard to the lighting and the sound and all the other electrical stuff that will happen in this space. Well, most of that is done. All the work on the air conditioners is almost complete, and soon they're going to be closing up the walls, doing the rest of the painting. And then that'll be followed by the arrival of the chairs and the carpet and the stage and some of that. We'll be keeping you updated. God bless.
Gracious God, may your love and our lives come together in a life lived in love. May Jesus be our mentor and our model. And may the world see in us a life that is willing to put love first in all things. Amen.